Good afternoon to everyone. I would like to thank Professor Hugo Carraro for giving me the opportunity of presenting for the second time at this conference. I'm currently a PhD student in the laboratory of Professor Protasi at the University of Chieti. And today I present the work carried out for my master degree dissertation and the initial work I'm doing for my PhD. Heat strokes are crises characterized by abnormal increase in core body temperature above 40 to 41 degrees, triggered by high environmental temperature combined or not with humidity. And heat strokes are quite frequent during heat waves, a period of unusually hot weather, especially dangerous for human health in large urban areas environmental heat is exacerbated by lack of vegetation, air conditioner, and cars. And one of the factors that can predispose individuals to hyperthermic crisis is intense physical exercise in adverse climatic conditions. And in this case, the crises are called exceptional heat strokes. In humans, there is another syndrome characterized by abnormal increase in core body temperature, susceptibility to malignant hyperthermia, a rare disease triggered by halogenated anesthetics such as halothane, commonly used in emergency room. And most, but not all, human families affected by MHS have been linked to mutation in the gene encoding for the ionity receptor type 1, the calcium release channels of sarcoplasmic reticulum in skeletal muscle. For more than 10 years, the laboratory of Professor Protasi has been working, thanks to funding from Italian Telethon Onlus and from NIH, on a project that aimed to demonstrate that hyperthermia triggered by anesthesia and overheating crisis induced by environmental heat or physical exercise are similar events just triggered by different stressors. And the molecular basis, the molecular mechanisms leading to rhabdomyolysis of skeletal muscle fibers during hyperthermic crisis appear to be a complex cascade of events revolving around the two main events: an increased leak of calcium from the ionity receptor type 1, the protein linked to MH that I mentioned earlier, and an increased production of reactive oxygen nitrogen species by mitochondria. However, one other important molecular event has been attracting our attention lately. During overheating crisis or during repetitive muscle activity, muscle fiber, in the attempt to reduce myoplasmic calcium levels, extrude ions into the extracellular space via plasma membrane ATPases. And in the end, this loss of calcium in the extracellular space results in an excessive lowering of the sarcoplasmic level of calcium, and a phenomenon known as SR depletions, and in the activation of a mechanism known as store-operated calcium entry, or SOCI. And you have heard extensively about SOCI from my supervisor, Professor Protasi. The activation of SOCI seems to be involved in a massive increase in intracellular calcium levels that leads to rhabdomyolysis of skeletal muscle fiber during an exceptional heat stroke. In a recent discovery, our laboratory have demonstrated that exercise drives the remodeling of the sarcotubular system and the formation of new junction that our lab named calcium entry units. And from the discovery of the calcium entry units, from what we know about the molecular basis of exceptional heat strokes, we developed the hypothesis that drove the experiment for my master degree dissertations. So could the assembly of calcium entry units be a factor that increases the risk of heat strokes when exercise is performed in challenging environmental conditions? So for this project, we used adult wild type mice that were divided in three different experimental groups. We have the control mice, the mice trained for 1 month by voluntary running in wheel cages, and mice pre-exercise 1 hour with a protocol that we already know from the paper from published in 2017 and 2019 promote the assembly of calcium entry units. and then the mice were subjected to an in vivo exertional stress protocol, which consists in an incremental running where the speed was increased from 5 meters per minute, and this is the speed you see in this video, up to 30 meters per minute. Using a treadmill placed in a climatic chamber where temperature and humidity were kept respectively at 34 degrees Celsius and 40%. During and after the exertional stress protocol, we performed the experiment you see listed here. And the first set of data we collected was the increase in core temperature of animals during the exertional stress protocol. And we measured the internal temperature of animal immediately before and after the exertional stress protocol. And in panel A, you see the final temperature recorded at the end of the exertional stress protocol. And in panel B, what is shown is the difference between the initial and the final temperature recorded. And the results show how the two groups of train 1 month and exercise for only 1 hour reached a higher final temperature compared to that of control. And this difference was statistically significant. We then performed an ex vivo exertional stress protocol on isolated EDL muscles. So the EDL muscles were dissected from the animals and subjected to a fatigue protocol, which consists in 150 consecutive tetani, each lasting half a second at 80 Hertz applied every 10 seconds. The experiment were performed in either in a solution containing 2.5 millimolar of extracellular calcium in panel A, or in a solution still containing 2.5 millimolar of extracellular calcium, but supplemented with 10 micromolar of BTP2, a specific blocker of SOCI. Trace is shown in orange in panel B to D. And in the bar graph at the bottom, we plot the specific basal tension recorded at the end of the experiment. And during this protocol, DDL dissected from train 1 month and exercise 1 hour mice developed a greater basal tension indicative of a contracture compared to that of control. And this contracture was significantly reduced by the presence of BTP2 in all three groups of samples. And the drop in the development of tension due to supplementation of BTP2 gives a direct measure of the contribution of extracellular calcium. So as entry of extracellular calcium is mediated by calcium entry units, junctions that are few and small in muscle from control mice, but then we already know should assemble following exercise, we performed quantitative analysis by electron microscopy of the two structural elements which constitute the calcium entry units. So the SR stacks indicated by the empty arrow and the inset in panel C, and the elongated T-tubule at the high band shown by the dark precipitate and the inset in panel B, and also the contact between the T-tubule elongation and the SR stacks, which is indicative of a fully assembled calcium entry units. And we analyzed EDL muscle before and after the exertional stress protocol. And the EDL muscle from any train 1 month and exercise 1 hour mice contain a greater percentage of fiber with SR stacks and the number of SR stacks per cross-sectional area compared to that of control. Already in basal condition in panel A and B, and both values further increase following the exertional stress protocol in all three groups of samples, though remaining lower in control specimens. We finally evaluated the elongation of the T-tubule at the high band, the second functional component of the calcium entry units. And the results show how the T-tubule elongation and its contact with the DSR are greater in mice trained 1 month and exercise 1 hour already in basal condition compared to that of control. Now, as a project for my PhD, we are also performing similar experiment in mice which are genetically hyperthermic. And in our laboratory, we have these two hyperthermic models. We have mice with mutation in The ionodine receptor type 1, which is linked to malignant hyperthermia in humans, and mice with ablation of calsequestrin 1, a protein that directly modulates the opening of the ionodine receptor. And the molecular mechanisms underlying the hyperthermic phenotype of these mice have been extensively studied in the past years, and I won't go again into it, but at least we already know that calsequestrin knockout mice undergo severe SAR depletion during repetitive muscle activity. And SAR depletion is one of the mechanisms that activates SOCI. So for this reason, we decided to verify the presence of the calcium entry units in the muscle of these mice and their possible implication in the susceptibility to an hyperthermic crisis. So we subjected these animals to the same accession stress protocol used in the first part of my presentations. And we measured the internal temperature of animals immediately before and after the accession stress protocol. And the results show how both males and females of both mouse models reach a higher final temperature compared to that of control wild type mice. And this difference was statistically significant. We then started to analyze the calcium entry units in the muscle of these mice in basal condition, so before the accession stress protocol. And this bar graph show how the percentage of fiber with SR stacks and the number of SR stacks per cross-sectional area are always higher in the two hyperthermic models in both males and females. And we still need to complete this analysis with the second functional component of the calcium entry unit, so the elongation of the tubule and the eye band and the contact with the SR stacks. In this slide, I summarized the main result I have presented today. And briefly, training 1 month and exercise 1 hour mice reach a higher final temperature during an in vivo accession stress protocol compared to that of control. And electron microscopy analysis demonstrated that their muscle contain a greater number of calcium entry units. And we are now collecting data in two different animal models, which are genetically hyperthermic. And these mice display hyperthermia during an in vivo accession stress protocol. And it seems, even if we have to complete this analysis, that their muscle contain constitutively assembled calcium entry units. And this data suggests that the assembly of the calcium entry units and the entry of extracellular calcium may contribute to an excessive rise in core temperature during an exceptional stress when exercise is performed in challenging environmental conditions. Does this mean that calcium entry units are dysfunctional? Absolutely not. We have extensively demonstrated how they help to limit muscle fatigue. And this data only underlines one of the possible mechanisms that may contribute to an exceptional heat strokes. We have only need to remember that animals may be smarter than humans. When it's too hot, they tend to hide and postpone activities. To conclude, I would like to thank all the members of the lab, the funding agencies, Teleton and NIH, which provided for the financial support, and all of you for being online today. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Please, somebody has a question?
I have a question. You say that you see these junctions more often. How many muscle fibers can you sample? Because I assume you can recognize these stacks only on longitudinal sections. Is that correct?
We analyzed fast twitch fibers because they are easier to fatigue. And so we analyze the fiber in electron microscopy analysis.
He asks, how many fibers did you look at? If you go back to the bar graphs, probably you have the numbers there about how many fibers can you look at.
The number indicated in the graph is the number of EDL analyzed, not the number of fiber we on which we perform the analysis.
Approximately how many fiber do you look per muscle?
100 fiber.
Okay, thank you. That's enough.